have Richard Snow. How are you, Richard?
I'm very good, thanks. How are you?
Excellent. Very good, thank you. And Richard is the author of a new book about Henry Ford, I Invented the Modern Age, The Rise of Henry Ford. So, very interesting book. I've been reading a few excerpts from the book, and he was quite a character, Mr. Henry Ford, huh?
Oh, he certainly was, and a very unusual man, in that he could be extremely good and extremely bad.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I was reading some of the reviews on your book, and if I understand, like, he wouldn't survive today, right, in the corporate America?
No, he certainly would not. But in his day, he was certainly the richest man in America, and one of the most powerful. And I think his name is still famous, and of course, if you go outdoors, you can see it on a car on the street any day of the week. But he began out of nothing, and he was very early convinced, at a time when there were no automobiles, really very few automobiles in America, that this was the becoming thing. And what cars there were would cost maybe $5,000-$6,000. This would be about 1905. When a nice home in a nice town would cost, $1,500.
Yeah.
Ford thought that the automobile would change the country and the world if he could get it in the hands of people who could afford it. If he could get it in the hands of people who didn't have a lot of money. He thought it's a car that should be owned by every farmer, every shopkeeper, and every working man in the country. And he built a car that was easy to fix. It was as ugly and as reliable as a cast iron stove.
Yeah.
And he sold it cheap. And it made a tremendous impact. And in the end, he built 15 million of them. And it changed the way Americans lived within a decade. But in order to do that, he had to figure out a way how to build it very fast.
Yeah.
And when he started his factory, if a carburetor required a person to do 21 things on it to put it together.
Yeah.
He then broke that down. He had 21 men doing one thing each as it went by them. One would add a bolt, one would add a valve. It would go by them on a moving assembly line.
Yeah.
And that was basically the beginning of mass production. And he was able, in the end, when he had his whole plant working that way, he went from turning out 340 cars a day to one car every 10 seconds.
Yeah, and it's pretty amazing. Like, the people still believe, some people still believe that Henry Ford invented the car, but that's not the case. His great contribution to the car industry is what just you described, making it fast, making it cheap, and making it available for a lot of people, right?
Yes, exactly. And that mass production spread to every industry, and that had the most tremendous effect on the country, on the national wealth. And in 1914, he did a very radical thing that surprised everybody, but he doubled his workers' wages. He established the $5 day, which doesn't sound like a lot now, but that was twice what the manufacturing wage was.
Yeah.
And that allowed, at one step, that allowed the people who built his cars
to buy it.
Exactly. Yeah. Nobody who put together one of those big expensive cars could ever in his life save up enough money to get it. But anybody who worked on the Ford production line could own a Ford, and so his workers became his customers. And this really began a consumer cycle that's still going on in our country, and it built the middle class as we know it today.
Yeah. Probably Ford employees can buy cars today. But back then, doubling the salary will be another reason for why he wouldn't survive in corporate America.
Oh, absolutely. No, you don't see that happening a lot these days.
Yeah. So another thing that a lot of people don't know about Mr. Henry Ford is that he failed at the beginning, and he wasn't very successful until he was, not late in his career, but when he was 40, I mean...
No, that's absolutely true, and it was sort of late in his life. He was... he was in his 40s before he got going, which is pretty well along in years when you're gambling on something absolutely new. Yes, he got backing for two companies and walked away from both of them because he wasn't ready. He hadn't yet figured out how to do what he wanted to do, and when he found out he couldn't, he sort of disappeared. But the third time he got it right, he established the Ford Motor Company in 1904, and it's still going today. But he said a very interesting thing years later. He said, of course, in the beginning, there was no demand for the automobile.
Yeah.
There never is for a new product. And you think of it sort of the other way around, that necessity brings in the new product, but not at all. I mean, and it's true, nobody knew they needed an iPhone until they had one.
Exactly. I believe one of the famous quotes from Mr. Ford is that if he had asked people, they would want a faster horse, right?
Exactly. What do I want with this? It makes a lot of noise. I don't get it. How does it run? It looks dangerous. You know, all the things that did resist. But once he got it out there, there was a fantastic demand for them. Until in a survey taken about 15 years after he started going, a significant number of housewives said they would give up their food and shoes for their children before they gave up their car.
Wow, that's amazing.
It was probably a hit.
It's probably true today too.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
I certainly would have when I was 17.
Yeah. Absolutely. So we're talking to Richard Snow, the author of a new book about Henry Ford, I Invented the Modern Age. And what inspired you to write this book?
You know, he at the end of his life, he built a wonderful museum right outside of Detroit in Dearborn, Michigan.
Yeah.
And it was a museum about American history. And he was able to collect on such a big scale, but he'd always admired the inventor Thomas Edison, who gave us the electric light bulb. Edison had a factory in New Jersey where he'd invented it. Ford brought the factory from New Jersey to Detroit, along with 7 freight car loads of New Jersey dirt, so it could stand on its own soil.
Yeah.
And he eventually had 110 buildings where the Wright brothers built their airplane. All of that was there. And I went and visited it, and it got under my skin. I was absolutely fascinated. I thought, what kind of a man would put this amazing town together? And that's what got me going.
Yeah, it's a fascinating place. I have the luck to be there a few times, and actually I'm going there next month again. And,
oh, that's great. It's really terrific, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And as you were mentioning, it's not only about cars, it's about American history, the Wright brothers. And in the museum, he has not only Ford cars, he has everything. He has locomotive, he has cars from other manufacturers. So it's
right,
a very
airplanes,
interesting
airplanes, everything. It's all beautifully displayed. And he has a wonderful eye for detail. And in that big museum, there's a cabin from one of the earliest motels in the 1920s, and you can look in the window into the tiny little room. There's a comb sitting on a dresser, and there are little ants going across the comb. That's the kind of care he took with detail.
Exactly. So, Richard, tell me, without giving up much about the book, but can you share some of the, let's say, worst things that you found out about Mr. Ford that are in your book?
Some of the bad things?
Yeah.
Oh, well, yes. There are a lot of them. He got very, very... it's mysterious, but I think, once he had this car, he didn't want to change it. He had it in production for 20 years, and that was too long. It had been a big pioneer. It did what it did, but by that time, people wanted, a more comfortable car, and Ford wouldn't change. He loved his car. He saw it as a moral object even. And when people tried to make him change it, he got angrier and angrier, and he lashed out at everything, including his son, whose life he pretty much destroyed because his son wanted to build a second generation of Ford.
Yeah.
But the thing that he's still remembered for, and that's most ruined his reputation, was that he suddenly decided that Jews were responsible for all the trouble in the world, and he bought up a newspaper in Detroit called the Dearborn Independent.
Uh-huh.
And then he started for a serial of 90 issues of it in called The International Jew, Mankind's Greatest Problem. And he carried on this very ugly anti-Semitic campaign for months and months and months. And his dealers were begging him to stop. Everyone was begging him to stop. But he was, you know, that same stubbornness that allowed him to develop this wonderful industrial enterprise also made him cling to an ugly and stupid idea long after he should have dropped it.
Yeah, pretty fascinating book. I'm really, really looking forward to finish reading it.
Thank you.
And so again, Richard Snow, the author of a new book on about Henry IV, I Invented the Modern Age. And so the book is available everywhere, right? Amazon.com, everywhere.
Oh, yes, yes.
And where can audience can find out more about you and your books and everything else?
Oh, they can look me up on Amazon. I'm there. I also have a website under Richard-Snow. It's just pretty primitive, but I'm working on it.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for your time, Richard. I really
enjoyed it. Thank you. It's very good to talk with you.
Talking to you. And again, congratulations on the book. And I highly recommend it to everybody who is listening.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Take care now.
Ahí tienen a Richard Snow, el autor de un nuevo libro sobre la vida de Henry Ford, I Invented the Modern Age, yo inventé la era moderna, y entonces habla sobre cómo Henry Ford, el fundador de la Ford Motor Company, tenía sus cosas buenas y tenía sus cosas malas, y bueno, así fue como se ha fundado una de las empresas más importantes, no solo de la industria de Estados Unidos, sino de todo el mundo. Esto es Auto 060, yo soy Javier Mota, y cuando regresemos vamos a hablar sobre el intento para romper un nuevo récord Guinness a bordo de un Volkswagen Passat con tecnología TDI, Cleaser.